I'm currently a volunteer at the GIC. Before the talks begin, please make sure your cell phone has been turned off or switched to client mode. Ladies and gentlemen, today's tour will present the work of the conservation organization First Korea and provide a bird's eye view of the meaning of sustainable development. Through narrative and some beautiful images, the tour aims to help audience members to make connections between birds, landscape, and themselves. Dr. Nial is director of the Bird Korea, a legally registered NGO dedicated to the conservation of birds and their habitats in Korea and the wider region. He is coming to the GIC together with other environmentalists from Hwasun, Mokpo, and Busan. With an office in Busan, the organization uses science and education to promote sustainable development. Now, Dr. Nial Boris will share with us his first visual recollection. Let's give him a big hand.
Greetings. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Nial Moores. I work for the conservation organization Birds Korea, based in Busan. And as the very wonderful introduction before, I came today with several colleagues that I'd just like to very quickly introduce. First, our national coordinator, Hakmina Sunsenyi. As she will tell everybody during question time, she's the boss. Then there is Mr. Andreas Kim in Mokpo. We're hoping that after today, if you're interested, you'll look at our websites. Our websites are in English and also in Korean. So they have many thousands of images of birds and of places and telling the conservation story. And Mr. Andreas Kim is the manager of these websites. So thank you. Also, our volunteer teacher from Kimhae, Mr. Jason Lockery. We also have several other people who are working with us. Professor Lisa Maria, as many people will know her. Mr. Paul Mosin, Professor Sung Ha Chol also. So welcome to you and his students today. Thank you. Before talking anymore, I just really want to say thank you to everybody for coming today. Such a terribly hot day to be sitting inside on a Saturday. Thank you for that. We are very happy as an organization to be here because we see many similarities between the much larger GIC and our own small organization, Birds Korea. The title of today's presentation is Visible Connections. Excuse me. This is a kind of a cheat because it really takes from the name of a book that we helped to produce called Invisible Connections. I never liked that name because really what we're talking about is helping people to see the connection between themselves and others. Next. Visible connections between birds and their habitats, where they live, between birds and people, and of course, also between people and people. So this presentation, I will try to introduce our work in 3 or 4 minutes, talk a little bit about why birds. Can you show hands? Who here likes birds? Okay, go to 5 or 10. I hope at the end to do this again, and please everybody raise your hand. Why birds? And also explain this connection a little bit. Birds and sustainable development? Sustainable development? What is birds to do with sustainable development? This is a very core, central part of our work. When we talk about development, the future, we can't be only talking money and economy and business. We have to be talking about the other pillars of development, social development and environmental conservation. These three pillars together can help us to create a much better world to live in. And not just for us thinking about us, one person, or one town, one species, but there are possibly on this planet as many as 30 million species. And we are just one. Just one. So, in talking today, I hope to try to maybe clear these connections a little bit and invite many questions from you. Before I carry on, am I speaking at an okay pace?
Yes.
Is it okay?
Yes.
Not too loud? Not too quiet? Okay. Next, please. Our work. Firstly, we have a mission. Conservation of birds and their habitats in Korea and the wider Yellow Sea ecoregion. Conservation. Anybody know what that word means, conservation? Can someone tell me? Yeah. Excellent. Okay, to keep something from disappearing or going. To manage wisely. It's different from the word preserve, like jam in a jar. Conserving is making the best choices, the wisest choices to manage a resource in the best way. To conserve birds and their habitats, where they live. In Korea and the wider Yellow Sea ecoregion. I'll explain why we cover this big area in a little while. We do research. Sometimes we get very wet, wading into the tidal flats. Other times it's only close to our house. Is there chedi there? Is there chilredis there? Is there many sparrows there? It can be any kind of research. Next, please. We produce reports. We believe that an NGO, MPO, needs to use science. It's great to have heart. It's important to have passion. But there needs to be knowledge and science to support that passion. Otherwise, it's our word against another's. So we try to use research to find out which species are where. What's happening to these species? Is the population stable, increasing or decreasing? And ask the question, why? Next, please. We also do some planning and design. Planning at the kind of large scale, trying to get many organizations talking with each other, and designing even at the smaller scale. Who here knows Mokpo? Everybody's been to Mokpo?
Yes.
Yeah? This area is the Mokpo Namhang Urban Wetland. It's a very small area, which we worked many years for. Next, please. And rather than just say this is a really important place, we created designs that would help to increase the value of that area to people and to birds. To improve its quality for water purification, to create a nice space for people, for recreation, to create a good space for environmental education. Next, please. Not only to do the research and the planning, but we also do what we can to get people out to look at birds, or look at wetlands, or look at where they live. So many people say to us, I had some strange sound. I don't know what it was. Like a sound. Is it a bird? Probably. We want to encourage everyone to start to look and listen their own neighborhoods. It's not only the buildings, it's not only the people that make a place. The other species also create that sense of place. Next, please. We publish reports. Next, please. And we try also to raise awareness, not angrily, but by providing this information freely, openly, to decision makers. It's a democracy. Our leaders are elected. They represent us. So it's not for us to tell them yes or no. It's up to us to provide them with the best information, honestly, in the best way possible. So this little wetland, we worked, how long? 4 years? 5 years?
Since 2006.
Since 2001. Getting older. 7 years. And we're losing. The area is being destroyed. Even now, today. Heartbreaking. But it's part of the process of this kind of work. Why education is important? Because conservation, keeping something, is not about a decision today or only tomorrow. It's about your children's future, your grandchildren's future. It's a very long-term commitment to understanding and valuing a place. Next, please. And this kind of is a lot of the focus of our work. Maybe can we have some of the lights down? You don't need to see me, right? These lights are much prettier than I am. So, can we turn off some lights? Birds. Every one of these little boxes is a different species of bird photographed here in Korea. So before I move on and not Professor Sung or his students, about how many species of bird are there in the Republic of Korea? Anyone want to guess?
Around
100,000. 100,000 would be a lot. That would be a lot higher than it is actually. Number of species, yes. 350, you're very close. You're very close. Actually now, next please, about 530 species of birds in Korea. So if you start thinking, okay, more, mitpidulki, rufous turtle dove, tree sparrow, magpie, 530 species, it's quite a lot. And these species, every single one of them is a species because they live or use the habitat a little differently. This is why they're species. As different from a cat and a dog, a species. 530 species in Korea. 400 of them every year. This is Korea's natural history, natural wonder. And of these species, 90% are migratory. Now, migration means another question coming up, everybody, not for professors, or we're students. Migration means what? Anybody know? Was that an answer? No. A seasonal movement. A seasonal movement by an animal is migration. These birds are moving usually from the north, where they nest, Russia, the Arctic, Alaska even, through Korea, some to breed or winter here, others all the way down to Australia or New Zealand. So I said, we work for Korea and the wider Yellow Sea ecoregion because birds don't know boundaries. You cannot say to the bird, oh, this is Korea, protect this and then forget it when it flies 100 meters across the border to China. So like we think a little, like the work here, the world we accept really is one. People, we come from different countries, different cities, we have some different ideas, but we're united as a species. All of us laugh and cry, all of us have passions, all of us feel love. These birds help us to see beyond the barrier between me and you, between you and you. They help us because they cross these boundaries and they see the world as natural, as one connected space where the air and water moves. Next, please. And the wonderful thing about birds for helping people get a sense of environment is we can see them almost everywhere. Yeah? So, you know my style already, it's like a test. I'm sorry. Anybody know this guy here? This bird? Barn swallow or chebby? Chebby, barn swallow. And then surely everyone here has seen this bird. GIC or magpie. Both of these birds live close to human beings. Both of these birds have stories connected to them. They bring good luck. Or there's a magpie song in many countries. Yeah. Please, if you can sing, please do. It's good. These birds are very familiar to us, right? They share the same spaces with us and we see them. More surprising for many, maybe, the chebby, the barn swallow. You know this is a migrant bird. Do you know where they go in winter? To the south. How far south do they go? Just China?
Vietnam?
Maybe Indonesia? Some maybe make it down even as far as Australia. Amazing. Little bird like this. What is it doing? Amazing. So birds are almost everywhere. Almost. Next, please. But they're really concentrated. The biggest number of species, the biggest number of individual birds is where really the food is. Like people, birds just need to eat to survive, energy for their lives. So some birds, they have very long legs, long neck, for walking in water and catching fish. Like this egret here. Some shorter, stronger bills, eating vegetable, plants, roots, buried in the mud. Some, like this incredible, wonderful bird, the bar-tailed godwit, have this really long, slender bill, running along the tidal flat, sawing down into the mud to take the worms out from the mud. All these different shapes and structures are connected to their habitat and to their food. Their structure means they can only eat one kind of food. We use chopsticks, a spoon, a knife, and a fork. The bird uses its bill. So this bird can only be in this place if the food for that bird is there. And of course, the birds use their bills, and humans use different kinds of tools to take the same kinds of food. People use nets for the fish. People use little trawls for the shellfish. People use rakes for the clams and for the worms. We share the same habitats together. We both depend on the same habitat. Therefore, when we talk straight away about conserving birds, we're also talking about conserving people. Next, please. This connection of bird and human, I think everyone is familiar at least one or two stories about birds. And this guy here, the crane, Turumi, has very special meaning in many parts of East Asia. If you see a crane, you'll live 100 years. Wow, fantastic promise. And these birds are painted on so many things. On aeroplane fins, on trains, billboards, restaurants. The crane, see the crane. Who here has really seen Tulumi? A few. Not so many, huh? This is a bird, next slide please. It is actually a bird of wetlands. Subtian Luk. It's not a bird you can see in the river in Kwangju. Those are penguin, egrets. The crane is a bigger bird. It needs a really healthy ecosystem. It needs a place with good water, plentiful food, large, so it can escape from danger. It cannot adapt well to the tight city that we create today. So why this bird? Well, this is drawn in a pine tree. It's a bird of wetlands. It's got very long legs for walking in water. It's got a strong bill for eating fish. Not like the woodpecker, taktakari. This is for eating fish. I believe it's because where cranes were, people knew, aha, this is a good place to live. If cranes are here, there's water. If cranes are here, there's fish. If the pine trees are here, this is building material for our house, for our town. So when we see a crane in a pine tree, it means this is a place we humans can also live. And if we see these cranes, we can live a long time. Our development can be sustainable. 100 years or more, our generation, the next generation, can live here. Next, please. But now, the truth is this species has a world population of less than 3,000. In the whole world, there are less than 3,000 tulumi. 2,750 remaining in the world. I think there's more image of tulumi in the restaurants in Kwangju than there are tulumi in the world. This is an amazing change. A bird that was once familiar and revered has almost disappeared. Next, please. It's easy to understand why. This is a photograph of Hainan in 1951. Oh, beautiful. Skies are blue, water's blue, not so much forest, but the mountains and air is very clear. Next, please. In the same area, Hainan, not so far from here, 1951. Terribly hard life for people. Terribly hard life. But the families were together. The people lived on their land. The people lived a tough life that had at least maybe some balance. Next, please. And now this is the agriculture system of today. Not Hainan, Solan. Not any old place, but this place was identified by the local government in Solan as an internationally important wetland for water birds. Prize area. Rivers are dug up, concrete banks, the rice straw wrapped in plastic. Next, please. And the Yongsan River. This isn't pictures done by an NGO to protest. This is to boast, to promote. This is how our rivers can look. Let's remove the shallow river. Let's remove the vegetation. let's take away all the food and natural energy from the system, and let's call this river restoration. Next, please. We use science. We might be angry at these kinds of things. We might be very sad. We know the red-crowned crane disappearing. We know many other birds are disappearing. But only to say this has no meaning. We use science. Perhaps a little bit hard to see. MOE, Pang Yongbu, Ministry of Environment. We took their count data. So every winter, many people go out and count all the important places in the Republic of Korea. The number of birds is on this side. 1,200,000, 1,600,000, 2 million. The year is at the bottom. 2006, 2007, 2008, 2009. At this time, many people counted many places, and we got the highest count of water birds so far recorded. The Four Rivers Project started, and even though more places were counted, the number of birds has declined. Why? Because when you take the food and the energy out from the system, the birds cannot survive anymore. So when some people say to us, are you against the Four Rivers? Are you? That's not our place. What we can say is that project caused massive declines in water birds. This tells us that this project led to a loss of natural habitat. This tells us it's not sustainable development. Environmentally, it didn't conserve the species. Next, please. And then this is going to get even heavier. Please help me, someone, with a joke. Tidal flats and reclamation. This was a picture of Semangam. People here know Semangam? Yeah. So, we did a lot of work at Semangam. It's a very huge area. Very huge. Two rivers and tidal flats, 25 kilometers wide. It was the most important place in East Asia for most shorebirds. 2006, many people, many birds existing together. Next, please. One of those birds is this guy, the bar-tailed godwit, size of a pidulki. Only a small bird with a great big long sword bill. Next slide, please. This guy, these are all bar-tailed godwits. They spend our winter, November, December, January, in New Zealand, and some in Australia. How do we know? Because many of our colleagues in New Zealand and Australia put distinctive individual bands on their legs. So when we see this bird, we know, okay, it was in New Zealand. It was in Australia. These same birds, we know they spend the winter, our winter, here. Then, every year, March, April, May, they're in the Yellow Sea. That's a long way away from New Zealand and Australia. Then, in our summer, this time of year, the same birds with the same patterns are being seen in Siberia and also Alaska. That's a long way to go. If you came today across Gwangju, maybe you felt a little bit tired coming here. Think about this bird. That's a heck of a long journey. Next, please. But the question for many, many years was, how do they do this journey? you know, this is a bird only the size of a pigeon. It's in New Zealand. New Zealand is like 8,000, 9,000 kilometers to Korea and China. How could a bird the size of a pigeon do this flight? But we know, here they are in New Zealand, next please. And here they are in the Yellow Sea. Next please. And then in the summertime in Alaska. How do they do it? Next please. They fly it in just two main flights. Non-stop. The birds in New Zealand will spend several weeks feeding until the whole bodies are swollen, really swollen with fat. This fat is the energy they use to fly. Come the evening time, down in New Zealand on a still March night, some birds will start to call and then up they'll go. 10 at a time, 20, 30. Size of a pigeon. And then these birds fly non-stop. No sleep, no food, no rest, no maps. They fly for a week. A week. Can you imagine? About the size of a pigeon flying for a week. During the course of a year, these birds fly 30,000 kilometers in 1 year, next week. And by the use of satellite transmitter, we know this individual bird, she flew non-stop at least 10,100 kilometers from New Zealand to China, 7,000 kilometers to Alaska, and then in the autumn time, as the typhoons move across the Pacific, she got up and flew non-stop, direct, across the Pacific, all the way back to New Zealand. Non-stop, no map. We went to a restaurant at lunchtime, I couldn't remember the way back. Can you imagine, 11,000 kilometers non-stop, just flying. It's a flight of faith. The only way these birds can do this is because over thousands and thousands and thousands of years, they evolved the structure to do it. But it's a fine balance. They use that bill to feed and feed and feed and put the weight on. That's the weight they need for the flight. An incredible journey. When they get to the other place, there's no body fat left. And if that tidal flat isn't there for them, what happens? What can happen? Just die. If they can't continue because the habitat is gone, they die. We talk about the Olympics. Oh, how wonderful. Sports team, someone played an hour non-stop. Whoa! Next time you see a game, please remember this bird, that journey. Because it's connecting with the powers of nature. It's connecting New Zealand to China and Korea. New Zealand people say, well, these are New Zealand birds. Chinese people, Korean people, these are our birds. Russians say they're ours. They're connecting people. And people need to talk with each other to find ways to conserve these amazing birds. Next, please. And here's the problem. More and more they do these journeys, they arrive, and the tidal flats are gone. Concreted. Wasteland. Our organization worked with Australians and other people from around the world to count the shorebirds at Seymangham. Seymour closed in 2006. 2006, 2007, 2008. The number of birds is here. After the Seymour closed, Year by year by year, the birds declined. No food for them. The bar-tailed godwit flew all the way from New Zealand, needing a larder of rich mud full of food, and found dead ground. And they died. For some people, maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe. But I ask you to think about that bird's migration. Doesn't it just make your heart lift to think the world is full of something so wonderful as that? Isn't it amazing that these places are so rich and special? Next, please. Next. Yeah. Sustainable development. The future of St. Andrews. Next, please. So a lot of our work has been invested in looking at tidal flats, reclamation. We believe that our greatest national natural treasure is our tidal flats. The tidal flats here, the Keppel, here in Korea, is extraordinarily wonderful. You think about the foods that most people eat, seaweed, shellfish, crab, shrimp, fish. It's all coming from the tidal flat. You think of the landscape, so beautiful, open space, and the value not only to local communities, but to the world, because these birds are using these places too. The scientific consensus is that reclamation, converting tidal flats to land, is not sustainable. Fisheries are collapsing, cultures collapsing, and many species of birds are also now declining. Some species, every year, 5 or 10% decline. One species, the nokchokkulidoyo, spoon-billed sandpiper, in 1 year, 26% decline, every year. This is a very bleak future for this bird next year. And this is the guy, spoon-billed sandpiper. Next, please. Like the bar-tailed godwit, like 90% of our species, it's a migrant. They spend the summer up here. They spend spring and autumn here in the Yellow Sea, Korea and China. And they spend the winter in more southern China, Vietnam, also Bay of Bengal. This tiny little bird makes this huge migration each year, depending on Korean tidal flats, the Korean capital. Next, please. In the summertime, it nests up in very remote areas in Russia. I don't know, can you see this? It's maybe too far for you in the back. Size of a little chicken chick with a spoon bill. Oh, so next, please. Then spring and autumn, places like Semangom, Kumestri, Komsomal, Nakhonggan, and Busan. Next, please. But this is the problem. I said we do research, so it's not only about like counting birds or something like this. We also measure tidal flat and we look at other habitats. Did you know, here in Korea, we lost 75% or more of our tidal flat? Only 25% remaining. Did you know? Were you aware? 75% Korean keppel has been lost. Half of this loss has been in the last 25 years. So I'm probably guessing almost everybody here is 25 years old or older, maybe some little younger, maybe. Basically, in your lifetime, over half of the tidal flats gone. Since I've been living in Korea now 15 years, wow, Namyangman, Asanman,
Same animal, gone. That's incredible.
The chain. Next, please. And the species, I don't know if you can see from that cute little chick with a really super cute to death on a tidal flat. We use science to try and help people to understand. Not to make people feel guilty, not to say you did wrong, but to say this is how it is. This is how it is. And with that information, we can begin to think a little differently. What is the best way forward from now? We want to make a place that's better for people and other species to coexist, to live together. Next, please. Without people caring, without people doing the work, the future of the spoon-billed sandpiper is forecast to be extinct by about 2025. 10 years. 10 more years is all we've got to save this little bird from extinction. 10 years. Short time. Next, please. So, as a little organization, we're doing what we can. Here's our wonderful national coordinator in a meeting in Seoul. Here's me, different shirt, but looking very... And I don't know if anyone recognizes this professor here. Hei-Chan from Iwate. He's joining the fight for the spoon-billed sandpiper. Also the mayor of Seoul. This is his name card. The mayor of Seoul has a spoon-billed sandpiper, Nokchok Puri-deo, on his name card. He is saying, come on, let's save this bird. Fantastic. Next, please. Just want to look at that for a while. The future really is now in our hands. And all of us, in our own way, have some power to change things for the better. All of us do. The decisions we make day to day. Next, please. From children to teachers, we can help to raise awareness. Talking with our friends. Making a decision on the kinds of things we buy or we don't buy. Making decisions on the kinds of things we value or we don't value. Saying to people, look at this tidal flat. This is beautiful. Don't worry to get muddy or dirty. This is where we live. Even just saying those things is the way to start to change the minds and hearts of everybody, we believe. So I'd like to ask you today, this is coming to the very end of my short presentation. I'd really like to ask you today, please, everybody here, please think of one thing you can do in your own life that can help, just help a little bit, raise some understanding about birds and the natural environment. Birds tell us about the health of where we live. If we look carefully, if we listen, really listen, they can tell us so much about where we live. They can tell us so much about how we live. The decisions we make. And for the sake of ourselves and of the next generation and the next generation, we need to conserve the birds and their habitats. We need to conserve our own future also. It's a very hot day. I thank you for listening so patiently. Thank you very much.
Talk. Now we're going to begin the Q&A, question and answer portion of the talk. If you did not receive a piece of paper when you came in, you can raise your hand right now, and one of our lovely volunteers will give you a piece of paper for you to write your question on, and they'll give it back to me, and I'll ask it. So, right before we begin, the last thing I'd like to say is please do not raise your hand to ask the questions directly. We prefer that you submit them in written format. Okay, with that out of the way, our first question is, first few questions are about you, a little bit about you. Not too personal, but where are you originally from?
I'm from originally, I like to say I'm from the earth. originally from the UK. So maybe people know the city I'm from, Liverpool, the Beatles, soccer team. Yeah, and what people, most people don't know about Liverpool is actually a really good estuary. There's some fantastic tidal flats near to Liverpool. It's a really, really good place for looking at birds. Next.
Okay. How long have you lived in Korea?
I moved here full-time in 1998. Yeah, 15 years ago. So I, before that time, I worked in Japan doing the same kind of work. And some folks from Korea came across to Japan. Come over here, Korea's better. More birds, more petrol, more tidal flats. So I moved, yeah, 1998.
Okay. When did you first get involved with birds? Presumably in the UK.
Yeah, when I was about 4.
And what did that look like? Were you just bird spotting or?
No, it's a kind of a longer story. Sorry about this, but I was actually born deaf. I had some adenoidal problems. I was born deaf. So I was taken to the hospital and very quick operation, and I could hear. I came out from the hospital. The first sound that I heard was street traffic. Now, can you imagine suddenly hearing cars and trucks for the first time? Terrible! I screamed and screamed. I can still remember now. The next sound I remember was much more beautiful. I was at home. It was night. Being deaf before, I couldn't hear anything at night. But this time now I could hear, and I could hear the sound. Wow, music. What the? What is this? I was so excited. Little kid, jumping up and down, I grabbed my grandmother. What's happening? What's happening? What's this sound? What's this sound? And she went, it's geese. Kirogi. Geese. I thought geese was like an angel, playing a trumpet. Laughing. So I said to her, please, 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 grandma, please, take me, show me, geese. What's geese? It's going to look like heaven. It's going to be amazing. Some brown gray bird. But the connection was made. From that time on, that sound takes me back to that memory. My world went from here, some small space, out. Just out. It was amazing, fantastic feeling. That's how it felt.
Okay. Did you immediately get involved with bird conservation as soon as you came to Korea?
No, I started late. My first action for bird conservation, I was 10. So yeah, I was an activist before I came to Korea.
Okay.
I was an activist in UK and Japan.
Okay. Are there many unknown bird species in Korea?
Now, nice question, but think about this. Are there many unknown species? If they're unknown, they're unknown. I don't know who asked that question. Yeah.
I'm just a messenger.
Okay. Yeah. There may be not so many. We don't know of any unknown species.
All right. Are there any success stories you can share with us about the number of birds in Korea increasing? Some type of bird that's on the upswing or anything?
Oh, that's a really difficult one. I'm going to tell two stories quickly. I apologize, quickly. One is Gachangori bicoteo. The bicoteo was very rare and became very common And 3-4 years ago, there was more than 1 million bicotyl. But actually, the last 2 years, the number started to crash again. That was the best story to tell. The other good news I want to say is thanks to the work of many local NGO and Birds Korea and other organizations, we have stopped some major reclamation project. We have. Thank you. Also, I want to say, before I came to Korea, 20, 30 years ago, there was a lot of illegal hunting of birds. This is now stopped almost entirely. It's fantastic. 40, 50 years ago, the mountains were bare. There was no forest. Now we still have about 63-64% forest cover in Korea. So these are stories that tell us things, good things can happen. If people want them to happen, they will happen.
Okay. Is there any aspect of Korean bird habitats that makes Korea unlike any other place in the world?
Wow. Unlike any other place, no. But I would say, again, the tidal flats of Korea. This is the west coast, south coast is so special on the global level. It's so special. And if we just have a little more time, in the future, many people will come from around the world to marvel. The Incheon, 9 meter difference between high and low tide, is fantastic. The open space, the shape of the tidal flat, the fisheries in Korea, amongst the most important fisheries in the world. This is because of this natural habitat also used by birds.
Okay. You mentioned a lot of tidal flats are disappearing. Are they being converted into fisheries?
No. The main process of, we call reclamation, reclamation, is building a wall and stopping the sea from coming in. And the main aim was to make rice areas before. By law, that was the primary purpose. But in recent years, this law has been changed, and now it's just being converted with the aim, sometime in the future, we'll do something here. So, I don't know how familiar you are with Saemangun, how much you know from the newspaper. But if you ride the KTX, you'll see the commercial for Aerial City, New City International Convention Center. There's nothing there. It's not built. There's nothing. It's just sand, dead sand, dying water. It's not being built. There's a Kevin Costner movie making some baseball field in a corn crop. Build it and they will come. This is Saemangun. This is Siwago. This is Namyang, Gyeongtaek. Build it, they will come. No, they won't. No, they won't. I'm sorry, I'm being sort of a very calm question and I'm talking to
you.
Okay.
What are some of the biggest challenges your organization faces?
We need more people.
Short and sweet. Okay. Here's a personal question. You seem to be an animal lover. Do you love any other animals besides birds?
I love people.
Any other types of animals?
Yeah, I love life. Doesn't everybody really, when you stop to think about it? Isn't life just amazing? And this life goes through everything from the tiniest little insect or all the way up to something huge like a giant tree. I feel a sense of awe. If I have a chance to connect. And this is one of the challenges here. We know there's so many people. There's so much pressure. And we don't have enough time. Everyone is so busy. We need all of us to make time just to go someplace and sit and listen. And when the ant starts crawling on your leg, don't brush it off. Watch it and marvel. That's what we need to make time for people to enjoy. All animals, pretty much. I don't like cockroaches.
Okay. That's really close to a question we have right here. Is there any bird that you dislike? Which one and why, if so?
Who asked that question? There's even a video of this. I don't like peregrine falcons.
Why is that?
You know, when you see a photo of them, or you look at them and you hear them, they're fantastic. These birds can fly so quick, and they can kill so easily. And that's what I don't like. I'm a vegetarian. So, if you had a peregrine falcon that only ate vegetables, I would love that bird. Now, I see too many killing, just killing. They seem to enjoy it. Some practice to kill. And it's some... Especially when it's some shorebird, I don't know. Wow, more.
Yeah, we got a ton of questions. We'll be wrapping it up pretty soon, but we have a few more questions before we wrap it up. So, humans cause a lot of negative things, but also so does nature sometimes. Like, for example, typhoons. Last year we had a really big typhoon, Typhoon Bulavan. Did you see a lot of damage caused by Typhoon Bulavan?
I was actually on hook sand though. And I have to say, I'm sorry if this is maybe politically very wrong to say, really enjoy typhoons. I love them. I hate that they do damage, but isn't it just fantastic, the power? I think it's so wonderful to say we aren't in control. We are just one species. This is not our planet. We didn't come along yesterday and this was all made for us. We just inhabit it. And do I believe in climate change? If this is another question, does Birds Korea believe in climate change? Yes. Is it caused by humans? Not entirely, but we contribute. Is there evidence of this? Yes, abundant evidence, scientific evidence. So if you worry and blame typhoons, blame human behavior. Please.
Okay.
That's your next one, right?
It could have been, but I might skip it. You mentioned something that I must confess to also. You like typhoons. I kind of like them too, because if they're strong enough, I get to stay home from work. So I do like them a little bit. Okay, here's a random question that's too good to avoid. It's really hot out today. Why are you wearing such thick clothes?
That is a really good question for the next time. I'm not answering any more than that, no. I have a cold. Yeah, it's air conditioners. Yeah, and there's air conditioning in here. And if there was no air conditioning, I'd be down to a t-shirt. Yeah, but it's, next please.
Okay. To be fair, the person who asked that prefaced by saying, oh, you had a wonderful speech, please come back. Why are you wearing such thick clothes? Okay, the last question, we have a final question here, and it's a pretty good one. A few people asked the same question, and it is, what would you recommend for average people to do to help the conservation of birds?
Oh, it's a wonderful question. There's, we need another hour. We've got the time. The first thing, really the first thing is mind. Really, it's your own mind. If you can find the time to look again at where you live, to look again and listen to where you live, to spend a little time to see actually what is there, that is, I think, the first most essential step. Because if you do that, you begin to see things differently. And by doing something differently, by you see some egret and you don't walk straight at it, you walk around it, other people see you. Why? What are you doing? we can see. And it changes attitude. If people know just how beautiful, how very beautiful their area is, some bird is, look closely at a gatsia, a magpie. Really, that shining color, it's extraordinary. And once you see that, that will help you take that next step. What can you do? Educate others. What can you do? Join its career. What can you do? Encourage students to do drawings or exercise and so on. Many, many ways.
Okay. Now, thanks a lot for the great talk and for answering our questions. Let's give him a round of applause. Of unanswered questions here, so if you'd like to stick around, we're going to have a discussion group immediately after the talk, and you can ask him directly. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for your perfect speech. We have a summer talking about creating mission for you that will be driving creating device.
Since we are talking about conservation, and the last question was what we do in everyday life, not for birds, but I brought one example to share with you. Can you imagine what this is?
I know what it was.
Yeah, what I am doing now?
I'm going to let you explain.
That's good for the response, as you have given all the time. After the consumption of the toothpaste, I cut it from the back. Then I use it again. Then usually it takes a month to consume the whole, then even inside. So one of the ways of conservation of the environment and the materials. And you know what this is? So I like this as a bottle. It is slender. As I am, and then is it easy for me to carry with water? I wash it, and then long time to get rid of the smell. Then I use it again as a water bottle. So some examples of conservation. I do so many other things, but this is not my time to talk about conservation. But I wanted to share this with you.
Thank you very much.
I do not make decision on my own. I have to get the opinion of my staff members, but I would like to have a link at our website to the Birds of Korea, your organization, for more people to get themselves exposed to your site and then to the idea of conservation again. Again, thank you very much for your wonderful talk. I have some more to share with you. Letter of appreciation, Dr. Nial Moores. How do you pronounce your name?
Correct.
Oh, thank you. I teach English.
I'm learning.
Let's have another meeting.
Okay.
Is that English grammar, I know far much better than you do.
I do so.
You have to learn some from me.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank you for your outstanding support to Bangladesh citizens at GIC Talk on June 22nd, and then we hope to have you again next time without cold.
Okay, yeah. Only in shell.
Yes.
Middle of winter.
Thank you very much. Your jobs will be shared with you.
I'm trying to stand away from you.
I hope you enjoyed today's talk. Next week, we will have a stroke and tire accountability for the past, life for the future, the third single month day. The speaker, Michelle Lee Jones, is graduate student and her